Hi, I'm Matthias Krings at Catenion. Let's talk about R&D project assessment. For early stage projects, the assessment aims to answer a few very basic questions. Which indications to pursue in what sequence? We do that in the option space. What is a viable product in each of these indications? This we discuss in product visions. What are the R&D risks of the project and its probability of success to proof of concept or POC? We cover this in the R&D risk assessment. And then, of course, what is the commercial potential per indication? It's covered in the commercial assessment. How do these dimensions fit together? We do this in consolidation and development strategy. Now, early stage assets, pre-proof of concept that is, have greater scientific and technical uncertainty than post-proof of concept projects, and especially so when dealing with novel targets, novel MOAs and or novel modalities. Often there are several indications that could be addressed. As such, several choices have to be made about the most suitable road to proof of concept. To inform these decisions appropriately, early stage project assessment must then cover options at hand in several dimensions. What is the option space of addressable indications? We cover this in six succinctly defined dimensions, and they include scientific confidence, unmet medical need, development hurdles, competitive situation, differentiation potential, and of course, commercial potential. And on this basis, typically few indications, two, three, sometimes five, should be selected for consideration in exploratory development on the path to proof of concept. These considerations typically also already imply a potential sequence for clinical development of the top indications. More on that when we discuss consolidation and strategy. Let's start with the product visions. For each indication, a product vision should be generated, specifying parameters that establish differentiation vis-a-vis current and anticipated future competitors so as to position the product successfully in the market. Oftentimes, a pre-selection of relevant indications exists in organizations that have defined their strategic space in the format of a disease map. That's the part that they want to operate in terms of therapeutic areas and indications. Note that at this early stage, product visions typically suffice for decision making, while in-depth target product profiles or TPPs would vastly exceed the effort for a little added relevance for decision making. Still, we will discuss target product profiles for late stage projects, that is, post proof of concept projects, in a different video. It is an unpleasant truth that most projects in biopharma R&D fail, as the industry's low transition rates from phase to phase tell us. All teams and companies are trying to beat the odds, and we have developed over the past 20 plus years, together with hundreds of experts and among our clients, a systematic approach to identifying, assessing, and quantifying technical, scientific, clinical, and regulatory risks with the intention to address and mitigate these risks where possible, and to make risks of different projects comparable. Catenion's R&D risk assessment brings a lot of value to project teams, functions, and decision makers for the following reasons. Teams are supported by a systematic structure to ensure no stone is left unturned. Having identified risks is a first step to planning risk elimination by setting up the appropriate analysis, experiments, and/or trial designs together with the team's functional experts and their functions peers. Functional leaders benefit from a systematic overview of risks across projects, enabling comparison of risk levels and drawing on mitigation strategies that have proven useful in related cases. And decision makers can rely on the best effort for complete coverage of risks across projects. Catenion's R&D risk assessment is a proven industry blueprint. It enables the portfolio analyst to assess risks together with each project team in the portfolio, and it ensures the same yardstick is used and fairness is applied to all teams and their projects. What's more, the R&D risk assessment allows portfolio managers to gauge project-specific probabilities of success, or POS, for project transition into the next phase of R&D. The R&D risk assessment is established in a user-friendly software, an easy-to-grasp structure helps establish common terminology for handling risks in the following risk classes: conceptual risk, infrastructure risk, non-clinical risk, clinical risk, CMC risk, and of course regulatory risk. The Catenion risk assessment comes in phase-specific versions from target identification to phase 3. It's available in versions tailored to small molecules, to biologics, to vaccines, and to CAR T-cell therapies. The commercial potential of early-stage projects comes with considerable uncertainty because future treatment algorithms, standards of care, and other drugs that are likely to compete in the indications market of the future are as yet unknown. As such, pragmatism and a focus on a few fundamental parameters, as well as scenario analysis, are key. Starting with the current treatment algorithms and standards of care, or SOCs, we assess what novel drugs and drug classes will potentially enter the market and gauge what their profiles in terms of efficacy, safety, convenience, etc. might be. In the indications epidemiology assessment, the structure of the patient population is sketched and the addressable stages of the disease and treatment lines are complemented with prevalence or incidence numbers where fit. This helps to identify the addressable patient segments of the drug classes established there and, of course, of the standard of care. The analysis also covers current price levels by drug class and especially of the standard of care, the patent expiry of key competitor drugs, and thus entry or presence of generics in the market. Finally, estimates of patient shares and the potential price levels provide the basis for a straightforward calculation of commercial scenarios, typically a base case and a high case, to provide the range of potential peak sales. Additional depth is used for late-stage projects because the pragmatic approach just explained here typically provides the required information for early-stage decision-making only. Now, when it comes to consolidation and development strategies for early projects, the above analysis that we just discussed for one asset in 2 to 5 addressable indications can be quite substantial in volume. As such, consolidation is a must for efficient decision making. Often there is an indication that can lead to a faster, a cheaper, or a more likely proof of concept, say by virtue of easier recruiting, fewer patients required, easier clinical readout, or stronger preclinical evidence, or similar factors. These are often referred to as proof of concept indications or sentinel indications. At the same time, indications with high unmet medical need, a chance to differentiate versus competitors, and as such, a high commercial potential usually are identified and are often selected as the commercial pillar indications, which provide the greatest support of the business rationale for the project. The development strategy for a single asset must recognize the differences of indications and the cross implications. Here are some classics: how to deal with different formulations needed for different routes of administrations, how to deal with different dosing and safety thresholds established by drugs already in the market in different indications. What implications do different price levels in the indications considered have for the sequence of development and launch in the different indications? And of course, which patient segments will be aimed at in confirmatory or pivotal trials? How can consistency of clinical endpoints, doses, patient populations be ensured from the start? Interested? Connect with Catenion today to learn more.